And now we're live on air. Hi, everyone. Coming to you live today, I wanted to introduce you to an author, Bryan Wilton. He wrote a book called Asatru Book of Days. And we just want to welcome him today to the channel. We got a lot of stuff to cover. Welcome, Bryan.
It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. I really appreciate the invitation.
Okay, so one thing, the reason why I wanted to do this interview, well, I've been wanting to do an interview with you for a while now about a lot of different things because I find your books very interesting. You have studied a lot of different religions, based on tribal and the areas that people live in, basically, which is good information to know. In fact, we're living in a time and era, really, where we really need to get back to the basics of tribal instincts because
I agree 100%.
Going crazy right now in the world. But I mainly wanted to see what your take was on this. Well, first of all, go ahead and explain to everybody what kind of what Asatru or Asatru is about, and then we'll start there. Go from there.
Asatru is a Christian belief of Europe, of the indigenous tribes, of the peoples of Northern Europe. It is the from that tribal aspect and that culture, you know, with the old gods of Odin and Thor and Frigga and Freya and all of these things. Did spiritual guidance for, you know, millions of people for thousands of years before the onset of Christianity. There's still a very viable, powerful spiritual development that can be achieved if you want to meet up to a standard. And I think that's part of what attracted me to it. It encouraged the idea that we really do have what it takes to become who we want to become. And that's really not based on someone else's opinion. It's based on our ability to live up to a standard, to indulge, to live a right life, and to expect results from right action. That's kind of where that's at. And as I looked at it, as I looked at Christianity, and I spent most of my life as a Christian under the mega churches here in Tulsa, and reading the Bible, as I made this radical change in the foundation of my spiritual being, look around at some of the other ideas that are prevalent. I found common concepts that were, and again, in all of these ancient tribal faiths, and many of the tribal faiths that exist today, such as the Native Americans' tribal faith. You know, there's a lot of common concepts in that.
Right.
Inspiration, imagination, a search for wisdom, compassion, you know, service to others. These kinds of things are the things that helped individuals become a good life. And I think that's the whole thing, is that we want to live a good life.
I agree.
We want to live in such a manner that our families understand that they are loved. You know, that we can provide for them, that we can protect them, that they grow up to be members of the community. And they'd be those are some of the things that really caught my eye about it. But one of the things is that powerful reminder. It was a powerful and constant reminder that you really do have what it takes to make it through whatever's going on in your life. That's kind of where I went with it. And I found a wonderful spiritual horizon towards.
Yeah, it is very interesting. I think I had ran across, you know, I study a lot of different religions as well. I think that you have to do that in order to be balanced and understand other people and their cultures and their belief systems.
I agree. Finding that commonality is the bridge.
Right. But it's also in the times that we live in, it's where we collide a lot as well. Because we're in, you know, a lot of people, they just don't believe in any belief system. So they say, I mean, we all have been raised a certain way, you know, with our certain faith and belief. it's instilled in us to a certain extent. But you do find a lot of people now, they absolutely do not want to say that they believe in anything. Have you noticed that?
The atheist is a curious proposition that submits to you that the universe originated in a cipher and rushes aimlessly nowhere. Their ideas might be the beginning and end of thought. Ego-boosting proposition that allows them to feel like that might float above the rest on their brain power alone. Time you submit a mental examination to a spiritual ideal, you can automatically see the influence that's going to originate from that. Mm-hmm. I really believe it's a boosting proposition it's poison. It's kind of a cancer. It's people. You see them move through the world and kind of operate. But at the drop of a hat, whenever some idea about spirituality comes up, they want to complain about the orthodoxy of any given faith as if it's the orthodoxy that has something wrong with it and not the man himself and his ability to implement it in his life. That's kind of the way I feel about that. Those people that would deny those things.
Right.
It's really, and it must really be, I think it must be the height of sin and of his spirituality because of their own ego. I think that's got to be one of them. I think that's got to be the height of a good sin, you know, is his spiritual development.
I agree with you. I mean,
because your ego is so big, well, I don't have to believe in that. Well, I assure you, they believe in something they use. Fall back on for guidance.
Right. And that is so true. I mean, I see nothing but ego. It doesn't matter where you are. It's just the main characteristic, it seems like. Used to, you could just call it out on people pretty quick. And now it's real prevalent, you know. People's egos are just at the forefront. And it's really hard to find people who are caring and, you know, compassionate towards others. They say they are, but their actions don't meet the words. And
that's the biggest problem with this web of the internet that we've created. There's always been the web of weird. People talk about that. That's the interconnectedness of all things. Everyone's kind of connected. You've heard the 6 degrees of separation. It's kind of like that. When we created the internet, a venue that has, we provided a venue for the rampant expression of egos with no responsibility for the things they might say. If you were to go to a group of men, let's say you look at any online argument, and you'll see one man come in there and spread some kind of poisonous idea, to troll it, as you will. You go to that same group of people in person. What do you think the outcome would be if you were to just jump into that group of men and say, you people are all stupid? we've removed that accountability and we're struggling very much to figure out how to set that example, how to remain positive in the face of that constant kind of onslaught, how to keep presenting positive ideals for growth and development. There's always somebody wanting to take a pot shot. There's always somebody wanting to boost his ego to this nebulous idea of the masses that he believes he's a part of. That guy over there is an idiot. Look at me. I'm not one because I pointed that out. And this is the height of folly. This is one of the things that men need to begin to understand that they control. Press all of that kind of... I mean, think about it. On social media, has toppled governments in the last couple of years. Teenagers to commit suicide. It has inspired murders. I mean, think about the power that's involved in this. And we're sitting here. People are not even aware that they're doing it. And they're sacrificing for these feelings of righteous indignation when they get on there and they talk about I hate this and I hate that and I'm going to be and all this other stuff. They're feeding on that negative energy as if it might make them powerful, when it's quite the opposite with regards to were to act in that similar manner, even at a family dinner, they'd be ostracized. They'd be run off. And we have got to remember as spiritual leaders, people that at certain points, we need to be able to call that out and say, look, that's not the kind of behavior that's acceptable by any stretch of the imagination. And they need to be ostracized. They need to be run off.
Right.
I mean, we've created a powerful tool, almost.
A lot of this is fear-based. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, I try to connect with people on chat boards or under videos, you know, to create conversations, because if we don't create some sort of conversation with all the divisiveness that's going on right now, we're never going to get anywhere. But it's very hard to discuss things with certain people because they are just riddled with fear. How do I know this? They immediately attack me with name calling and just, they can't complete a sentence without having like 5 cuss words in it. You know, psychology 101, it's the basic, you know, it calls them out immediately. That is a fear. That's fear-based. And
It is.
You fear something, you either run from it or you attack it. So by calling me names, you know, it may make you have an immediate gratification right then and there, and maybe you don't feel bad later, but it literally does nothing. And quite frankly, now I'm used to it, you know, and so it's like I'm numb. I have no, like, it doesn't do anything to me, you know. So if it were to,
you know,
be meant to hurt my feelings, that was a long time ago.
<You know? laughs> Right.
Way past
exactly that, right.
It's not even going to budge on me now because, you know, we all have this field up now and we're protecting ourselves. So it's like, that just goes away. But it's very sad that we cannot even communicate. This is the time frame that we're living in. We cannot have a conversation and try to understand one another. I try very hard to understand, especially with all this political stuff going on, I try to understand where they're coming from. And a lot of it is misinformation. They repeat a lot of things that they have heard on television, and they haven't done their own homework. So during that, though, you know, I try to give them, well, why don't you go check this out? This is what I did. I went and checked this out. Check it out and do some research on that. Get back with me and let me know what you think, you know, because they're not informed. A lot of them are not informed.
You know, Rush Limbaugh called him the low information voter. And it's a brilliant turnage of phrase. And like we were discussing, you know, in 1976, Milton and Rose Friedman wrote that book, The Tyranny of, and in it, he provides a Peace Prize in economics. And from that prize, he brought forth the idea of the tyranny of the status quo. And in it, he suggests that a president has roughly 6 to 9 months with which to enact whatever policies or changes he campaigned upon. In that time frame, there will be his opposition will continue to put forth the idea that harm you somehow. Now, it's going to harm you. Nobody really knows how it's going to change your life. It's how it's going to change your standard of living. They'll say, oh, you're going to lose benefits, or, oh, we're not going to be able to do this, or we're not going to be able to do that. And it is fear-based, and it's magnified tenfold when you get on the internet, begin to live in this fight-or-flight kind of mentality. There's a lot of, really and truly, there are hormones released in your body when that fight-or-flight mentality is kicked off, and people thrive on that, not knowing that it's really not doing them any good. And then if you put forth the source, like you say, now the source is not real. Now the source isn't legitimate. Now the source, that person's a little bit crazier, or that source, well, that's just a lie, or, you know, and we have Trump calling them out saying, look, this is fake news. These people are making this up. They're just But the media didn't make Trump, and they can't destroy him. And I think that's the thing that really, really frustrates these liberal people that engage in the kind of mindset. And right now, they're the ones engaging in it the most.
Right. Yeah, they are.
That same mentality. They're trying to do their best to prevent perception of a loss of power. But if you look at the last two election cycles, they've lost that mentality, that kind of socialist idea. They've lost throughout you know, federal, state, and local level of Democrats. It's been rejected en masse.
Yeah, which,
and they're going to continue to spread that.
It wasn't surprising to me at all, especially after the WikiLeaks, you know, came out and all of the stuff about the Democratic, you know, committee. It was just, you know, although I don't know, it's a lot of the information in there is disgusting, you know.
It really is.
But
you know what? There, pollster that got that election right, and he predicted in his polls that Trump was going to win, and he did it individual if they were going to vote for Trump, because people were still kind of afraid. This is such a different, this is such a radical change from the politics we're used to. What he did is he asked him, who do you think your neighbors are going to vote for? That's the kind of mindset we're really facing, is that people were afraid to suffer the attacks of these liberal hound dogs, but they would say, well, I think my neighbors are going to vote for Trump. And that, and in doing so, he predicted that Trump was going to win, and he was right. Of what you're talking about online, you know, who wants to suffer these attacks of people that we know and supposedly care about from being called stupid and made fun of and racist and bigot? I don't want to be considered that. But when they use the term so frequantly, what meaning could it
be? You run and you look at the definition, right, of what a bigot is, and they're the ones that are showing bigotry by what they're saying.
The
and how, you know, it's insane.
It is. It's the insanity of a wounded animal. I saw a quote from Winston Churchill the other day. I don't know if you said it or not. I mean, you saw it on the internet. Who knows how true it is? But he said the fascists of the future will pose as liberals. And they're right. You know, we're dealing with a spiritual fascism. We're dealing with a cultural Marxism.
Yes.
You know, you can't be that. And here's the part of the biggest thing is that once you begin to subscribe to those and you stop standing on principles that hold your life together, there's no limit to the amount of principle that they will expect you to sacrifice to continue to be a part of their liberal agenda or their spiritual freedom or whatever it may be. It never stops.
Right.
And then we're being told that this is the majority of America. No, it's not. It's like 5-7% of America. That's not the majority. Why are we kowtowing to these ideas? Clearly, that entire agenda has been rejected. For a conservative, we want to kind of be left alone. We don't feel like paying you that many taxes. We just want to work for a living. We want to be able to take care of our families. And here we have these multimillionaires who have decided that's not what we want for you. Time Trump gets up there and talks things, when the media gets on there and complains about it, it cements in my mind a further dedication to what he's doing.
Right.
And so, and I don't think they understand that yet. I don't think they've grasped that idea that you keep pointing this stuff out like it's a bad thing. We're sitting over here cheering with both flags in our hand, you know?
Well, you know, with Trump, here is the thing, you know, it's not just all conservatives that voted for Trump. There were a lot of liberals. The old definition of a liberal, right? I mean, because now, let's face it, we have this new liberal, progressives, or, you know, that have come on board. And so, but the old ones are still there. They're just somewhere in the middle. And, you know, so it's not just the conservatives. And in fact, Trump used to be a Democrat, remember? So I wouldn't consider him totally Republican, even though he ran on the Republican platform. Nevertheless, they're still attacking him as if he is genuinely a Republican, right? With all Republican values. We know that he was our only way, our only ticket in there to get some of these things changed. Why is that? People ask me that all the time. Why is that? Well, for one, he was already a billionaire, you know. So we needed somebody from the outside to come in who wouldn't get snowballed, you know, by the media and the government and everything else and not let them speak. I mean, I'm sure an average day American may be smarter than Trump and may have, you know, better ideas. Nobody's saying that that person does not exist. But we'll never know that person because they will immediately be blocked. That's just how the system is. And so
that's exactly right.
So we're lucky that we got him in there. And now the people that do support Trump are watching very closely. And we will be the first ones to step up and say, hey, you know, wait a minute. You know, there's been a few things that I've already done that on. And I've like sent a tweet. I don't know if he gets them. You know, I'm sure he doesn't. He gets a bunch of tweets now. I don't know. But, you know, you just have to keep pressing forward and let them know and keep a tally of what you don't like, you know. I mean, personally, I didn't really like the education pick, you know, DeVos or whatever her name is. But that's just my personal opinion, you know. So give them a chance, I guess, you know. And so that's where we're at. So anyways.
Well, I think one of them. We can be sure of about Trump is if it begins to go south, he'll make the change. Failing, we're going to try something else. And I think that's something that they always fail to recognize. That man will, if he finds a principle or he's working on something that's not producing the results he wants, he's going to go do something else. He's going to try a different method. A centrist, kind of populist, part of the Republican Party. And I think that has a lot of appeal to blue dog Democrats. That's why he won Pennsylvania. And he broke that blue wall. Democrats voted for JFK. They looked at Trump, and you know what? And you're right. There very much is this culture in D.C. that is isolationist. It is elitist. It's not rich versus poor per se, but it's almost nobility versus the common man. What does the common man really know? He's kind of an uneducated individual. Really, he doesn't have an understanding of the more complex principles. And that common man just ain't an individual up there that's going to tear through that. And I think that's what we've all been waiting for so long.
Yeah. I mean, right? I mean they're disconnected from the people. And Trump got out there and he was disconnected. You know, he was disconnected long ago, right? He was raised differently. We all know this. You know, he didn't know us from Adam. Until he got out on the campaign trail and started doing these rallies, that's where I noticed a change in him. And so he started becoming connected to the people. And that, you could tell, that was kind of like his drug, you know? He wanted more and more and more. He likes to feel connected to the people now instead of disconnected. He, you know, once he was in Washington and he was away from the people, you could tell he was getting a little uneasy. That's why... You know, okay, I'm going to do a rally in Florida. And, you know, kind of everybody was saying it was his ego. Well, I'm sure some of it is, you know, because that's what he's used to. You can't just remove him away from his lifestyle and say that never happened. That's who he is. And you can't change that. Just be glad that he's trying to be connected to us common folk.
I think that's one of the beautiful things of it is he went right around the media. And that is sensitive. I mean, news, however you look at it, is a for-profit operation. They're selling commercials, you know, and if they're building a president or tearing one down, either one's going to make them money. Went to Twitter and connected with, and he worked hard, you know, four or five rallies a day connecting with people.
Yeah.
Really, they expected that with Obama. They expected that their ideas, he was going to be cool enough and communicate. That it would continue on. The matter is, that was the limit. That was the limit of his ability and kind of talk. You know, it was a complete failure. Largest tax increase in history. People are suffering under that. We just, you know, they called it the Affordable Care Act. It was a continued assault upon our ability to live as the free men and women that we wanted to live as.
Right. And it actually started with George Bush. You have to admit, a lot of these policies and bills that were passed started with him, you know, like the NDAA. I mean, a lot of that is just, it takes away our freedoms. A lot of it does. People don't understand that. But with Obama, you know, he increased a lot of those things as well. Like propaganda is allowed now. So on the media, they can tell us lies. You know, everybody, I hear this all the time. Well, Trump lies. Hey, listen, Obama was full of it, you know, but the difference is Obama was an eloquent speaker. You have to give him that. He spoke very well. He had this calming sense about him. He could calm the masses, and he was believable, but it didn't match what he was doing. It was like the exact opposite. That's what drove me crazy, you know? So,
the Department of Labor statistics are that, remember the speech he gave saying that he would create 1 million new manufacturing jobs. We lost 303,000 manufacturing jobs. Donald Trump, he is actually bringing about these new jobs. I mean, I keep hearing that from liberals. Well, he's a liar. What's he lying about? What did he lie about? See, they're going to keep hammering that, you know, that the Russians influenced the election, that Donald Trump's a liar. What's he lying about? How did the Russians actively get in there and write on a ballot and then put it in the ballot box to such a large extent that it cost her the election? How did they do that? Draw me a map. Needless to say, they're going to continue saying the Russians hacked the election. How? When we know full well that you had a woman in Texas that's been convicted of voter fraud. We have it in Vermont. We have it in Chicago. We have it in Detroit where they bus in Democratic voters. We have paid protesters. Media is doing their best to create this narrative to stop this revolution that quite clearly the majority of American counties wanted. This is right. The thing, and the narrative never stops. I mean, we're told that every day. We make funny little jokes and snide comments. Trump's a liar. He's got a funny haircut. How's he lying?
Well, let me tell you, I'm glad you brought that up. And there has been a few things that he's gotten wrong, okay? And most of it's been statistics. Now, where is he getting those statistics? I've got a couple of video clips where he's like, "Well, I don't know. That's what they gave to me." They is the key. Okay, so he has people in the White House that were, you know, Obama people, right? They're still there. He hasn't replaced all of them. And then of course, a lot of people don't know about this, but one of the last changes that Obama did before he left office, it was just signed it like January 9th from Loretta Lynch, is they opened classified material to, what was it? 16, I think it was 16 different areas in government. So now where it was just the NSA, you know, it was focalized in one area, now it goes to 16. So all these different people are getting classified information, and guess what? That's where the leaks is coming from. That was done purposely. And a lot of people don't know about this. He has a shadow government. It's called OFA. No, I don't have my tinfoil hat on. Go to the website. It's OFA.us. And he talks about it. He's not denying it. This has been his baby. He's running it. Obama's running this thing. They're the ones that are going into all these town hall meetings and shutting them down with Obamacare. Do you really think people are for Obamacare? There's not that many people across this country that's for it. That is one of the things that is on their book, you know?
We're talking about 10 million people or 19 million people out of 300 million Americans. Those people are going to be taken care of. 64% of our national budget, it goes towards taking care of those people where they're not going to fall through the cracks. They're not going to be robbed, but people are telling that.
Right.
The unionized government bureaucrats that have been there from administration to administration, allies that are actively working against Trump within bureaucrats that are still there that are working against Trump. This cannot stand. The idea of a unionized government official to almost everything I believe in. I can't stand that. I cannot stand that idea. And then you have somebody like John McCain who's taken a cheap shot because he tried and failed.
Oh my gosh.
Turn around, you know.
I know.
He's terrible.
Oh, how is he still in power? How are the people of Arizona still voting for that man?
Did you see what he did like a couple of weeks ago?
Well, I saw him take a cheap shot. I can't watch most of that stuff. The news that I see today, it is such noise to me that it's offensive. It grates on my nerves. It's all nonsense. You can't watch it without almost feeling what they're doing, trying to create this narrative. And the people that said, you know what, I don't know that I believe that.
Yeah. My blood pressure gets really, really high whenever I watch the news, and it doesn't matter if it's Fox. You know, I have to watch certain reporters now. There's just certain ones that I like, but it doesn't matter what outlet you go to. There is several on Fox News I cannot stand, like Shepard Smith. Get rid of him. Let him go to CNN. He wants to be over at CNN anyways. You know, but. Let me tell you what McCain did the other day. So these Russian radio hosts, okay, they pulled a joke on three people. It's like Maxine Waters, John McCain. I can't remember who the other one was. Did you see this? It was crazy. So they
somebody pulled a joke on Maxine Waters. I'd like to see that.
Oh my goodness! So they acted like they were from Crimea or something. And they bought it. Ukrainian ambassadors. And they bought it hook, line, and sinker. These people, they didn't even check to see who was calling. And they gave them classified information. They have it on the phone. I mean, it's on the internet, but as fast as people were putting it up on YouTube was taking it down, you know, just like. It just irritates me, you know, because free speech is not free anymore, and you're lucky if you're going to get it, especially from people who rely on, you know, giving out information over YouTube as part of the way that they receive money, right? Because they've been taking them down left and right, and so a lot of these people are not going to be giving out information anymore. They can't because they had to leave and go find other jobs because YouTube shut them down.
There is that. And, you know, Twitter is in my account right now. I have no idea what I even said that offended them. Podcasts are pretty uplifting kind of ideals that people would subscribe to. But, you know, they've decided that they're actively censoring my Twitter.
It's a
I haven't received an email. I had to be told by somebody else that it's been done.
But you know what it is? It's these.
Oh, here's the thing, though.
Sorry.
With us, I mean, we can get in this kind of stuff and we can hash this out all day long. And it really does seem like a futile effort to build ourselves and take care of our families that we almost forget that that's the whole reason we're standing up against these kinds of ideals. They are a threat to our way of life, you know, and that's the thing about freedom is that we practice those kinds of things and building ourselves in our own by setting an example that others would wish to emulate. And we forget that sometimes these kinds of things will suck the core from our very being if we let them.
Right.
And that's the whole thing about my podcast is I try to promote those ideas of, you know, sticking together, of building the individual, of setting an example. Terrifying thing to these news agencies that have their own narrative to offer to the public.
Right.
Any man that's dependent upon a handout. They need a man that's dependent upon where they get their information from. And that's been blown up out of the water. He has removed the necessity for the common man to depend upon the evening news. And this is a substantial loss of power and a threat to their stability. The almighty dollar, any way they can. And they're going to do it by assassination, character assassination, that they, you know, they're not going to agree with it because it doesn't pocket. This is a problem. This is a big problem.
Yeah. Well, and again, it goes also back to the misinformation and the lack thereof of people actually doing any research. You know, if you really want to know what's happening, like the LGBT community, you know, I've heard a lot of that lately, that Trump went back on the LGBT community. He's not going to do, you know, for them like he said he was. That's not true. What's happening is he wants the states to take care of these things. That is what's happening in Washington right now. What used to be a huge government is being split. In fact, I think it's being like cut into quarters. And we're keeping just a small portion. The rest of it, you know, pushing off to the states, you take care of this, right? And that's the whole purpose of like downgrading the federal government. So I don't know. It's just a lot of misinformation. But one thing I did want to ask you about, Bryan, you're chatting a long time. I wanted to ask you about, because I know that you do have a lot of knowledge about the different religions and practices that people have. One of them is, I believe, the Wiccan are the ones who created this like spell, or, you know, got the witches together to create a spell against our president. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
You know, I look at that, and I read that article from the BBC, and my first impression was that it was a linguistic ruse. It was a real play on words that even the fringe elements of society, even the flakes of society, are against Trump, and it's kind of presented that, well, you should be too, and if you're not, you're more like these kind of flakes. Been on that, you know, but when you look at it, you've got, I saw the number of 10,000, but I'll tell you, there are literally millions of men and women around the world that subscribe to these kinds of faiths. The liberal mindset that really plays into that kind of idea of someone who would get in a room and burn a candle and talk about focusing negative energy towards Trump or binding him up and all that other stuff. What does that really say about that kind of individual? That the focus of everything in their life is upon doing someone else harm. It's going to play out. When you release those kinds of energies, and when I say energies, I'm talking about energies, and they're every bit as powerful as anything else. When you kind of release in that kind of stuff against someone else, then that's going to come right back on you. But it really is for the BBC, for the Associated Press, to put forth an article like that. 1,000 people. Drop in the bucket of the people that actually practice this way, these different ways.
Right.
It's the spin about the whole thing that is absolutely ludicrous. That we were supposed to believe that, well, these people, these flakes, are against Donald Trump, and you're kind of a flake if you're not against him too. Dumb they think we are. You know that, and there's going to be a certain low information voter that's going to buy into that. Oh, well, of these people, I mean, surely, no, these people are people who really don't want to measure up to a standard, and typically that's what I find with certain aspects of that community, is they're a group of people that will say, well, I'll take that God over there, and I'll take that God over there, and I'll take this one over here too, because they kind of suit my need to not really have to measure up to any standard, or that the excesses of personal behavior that I wish to indulge in, well, they might really be justified if I just kind of do this.
Right.
People that I deal with and associate with are truly very conservative individuals. We don't want to be a government. We're not interested in losing our firearms. We're not interested in paying more taxes. for the most part, we want to work a job. We want to love our family. We want to hold a good, you know, we want to be left alone.
Exactly right.
And that's the predominant mindset of so many Americans. I mean, isn't that the beauty of freedom in this country? Is that have this freedom of religion? That a news company, that a major news outlet would pick something like this up, of that thing you were just talking about with the LGBT community, saying the government, federal government, is no longer going to support them. 10% of the population. The idea that the states are going to handle it, yep, you're going to have to fight the battle on many different fronts. My suggestion to them that are going to have to fight that on many different fronts, how about setting an example worth emulating? Difficult to do for someone, for a man wearing a dress, to go into some kind of state legislature where everybody kind of knows each other and fight a whole new battle. 200 people in a city that has 700,000. That changes everything. That changes the battlefield they got to fight on. This witch thing, it's an extension. It's that same kind of mentality. When you start releasing those kinds of energies, when you start getting all these people together to do this, article I read that said the chains and put him in the basement, as well as the Trump supporters too. And then you had one lady that said, no, this is to bring everybody together, kind of. So these people aren't on the same, even in the article, they're not on the same page. It's dramatic. Those people may very well get together and burn a candle, do whatever they think they're going to do. All they're doing is releasing more chaos into the situation.
Yeah.
They're fooling around with energies. They're focusing their mindset and trying to create a reality that they would wish to live in. It's the grain of the rest of the world. There's no success in that.
Right. Well, and
it really is a spirit.
It messes up, what is this doing to our children? You know, that's what adults need to sit back and think. You know, they take their egos and they take their practices and their beliefs and they take it to the street and they want to be in front of the camera and they want all this attention. But what they're not thinking about is what's happening to our kids. You know, we're creating a lot of confusion for them and it's not right. I mean, they're already indoctrinated in our school system, in the public school system, they're already being indoctrinated. By the time that they graduate from high school, you're going to expect as a parent, you know, that they know everything that you learned in school, right? That is not the case. They learn different curriculum now than what we learned. In fact, they learn even different ways to get to the answer than what we learned. It is not taught in the same way. And that is why you see a lot of problems with, you know, teenagers and parents, you know, colliding with one another. It's because the family unit is not cherished anymore. You know, it's not really taught in school that you should stay tight-knit. And we were talking about this earlier on the phone. It depends on what kind of culture you're in, basically, what kind of tribe you're in, right? And whether you have that tight-knitness and you can overcome what's being taught in the school systems today.
That's been one of the things that aggravated me the most. And there's been this huge push within with certain people that I know that some of them are very well followed for the homeschooling. And I think that's one of the reasons supported Betsy DeVos. The government with its funding, you know, if you go to school, the school automatically assumes it has control over your child to an extent that supersedes the parents. This is offensive to me. Level, it's offensive to me to think that this school is going to make a decision that says, well, we kind of need to make that. We're going to have to call the authorities or whatever. Get out of my face. You know, this homeschool idea, that tribal mindset. If we bring a life into the world, if we take the responsibility to have this life, And this child and this wonderful creation, be it from God or from however you want to perceive it, responsibility of bringing that beautiful, and you just have a new grandchild. I mean, you see it right now. You're probably really feeling, I have this new part of my lineage, of my heritage is here in this world. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love it. Yeah. You know, and it's all about love, and it's about taking that, up your child off at school for the first time. Mm-hmm. And it's like you're sacrificing the beauty and the responsibility of raising this child to be a part of the tribe, to be a truly functioning aspect of society. Mm-hmm. Entities are trying to prevent that or interfere with that. I don't subscribe to it. But I've been rambling, and I've already lost my train of thought because I got so passionate about that ideal. My children are very special to me.
Me too. And yes, I do have a new granddaughter who was just born last week, and thank you for bringing that up. She's adorable, and
I think that's one of the things about the family values. I mean, if you're going to be a spiritual leader anywhere, or you're going to be some kind of leader, I mean, point in your life, at some point, people need to be able to look at your house and see that. Luke, you're raising beautiful children. You kind of had some aspect of having your ducks in a row. And I think, you know, an obligation. And these kinds of things about the BBC reporting about witches, I mean, that's just nonsense. I mean, that's obligation when we step into a different path of life that we really, our ducks need to be in a row. If we're on the fringe element of society and we figure out that this isn't working for us and we try some different way,
right.
Aspect of strength with our children, there needs to be some very clearly designed, you know, or clearly this is about growing up to be the successful people that we expect our children to become. That is antithetical to the way the government funds our schools. They're not interested in that free and become a success and become a millionaire or billionaire. They need somebody that understands when this bell rings, it's time to start work. And when this bell rings, it's time to go to school. And that training, that indoctrination in our schools is a part of that.
Yes.
That's where this idea of homeschool comes in, because there's more and more of us looking around society and we're like, and I heard Master Chim say this the other day, he's like, would somebody, this world needs to be shaken like an Etch-a-Sketch. I mean, in no uncertain terms, so we can start this over. And,
thank you. Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah.
We see our nation, and people are beginning to look up, look around and say, you know what, this is not really the life that we've been taught and trained to function properly in this post-industrial revolution, and then the nuclear family made it necessary that your child grows up and they need to move out and go get their own home and go somewhere else. And we sacrificed our family farms. We sacrificed our ability to stand on our own ground and feed ourselves. Everybody else for everything else. And we've become slaves to an economic tyrant, and we weren't even aware of it. I think this is at the root of some of this in return to indigenous and tribal faiths. Every day, we've been indoctrinated to school. We go to work every day, and we've got to account for every penny we make for trading our time for someone else's dollars, because everybody else is plugged into our home, the gas company, the electric company, our groceries, the food we eat, the water we drink, and everything we want, you know, this, everything we sit on takes that money. Somebody else already has dibs on that before we've even made it.
That's true.
Yeah. It's a soul-crushing ideal. But we've been doing it for generations. Well, that's what's expected. Farm anymore to go live on, to take care of those things. Our children are being raised and indoctrinated by someone else. Forward in the world, we're being told, and this liberal agenda is part of it, and the communist idea, somebody else is going to take care of that for you. You just need to go to work so you can pay your bills.
Well, some of them aren't even working. Some of them are living in their parents' basement. And that
I've had to live in my mom's basement, and that's not the best place to be.
That's kind of the analogy that they're saying. We don't have basements in Texas, so I mean, I guess some people do, but not many, because we live on rock here. But that's kind of the analogy going around, is that there is a lot of people that, you know, they're activists. They're out there, and I admire them for standing up for what they believe in. Don't get me wrong. I'm not downgrading that. I think it's great that we have the ability to speak our minds. Still, we're getting to the point where it's getting a little, you know, iffy here. But yeah, that is the analogy that they were using, of the kids that were living in their parents' basement. But I think we've all had to live with our parents, and nobody's dogging that, really.
Yeah, there's, I don't, sometimes you fall on your face, but we do live in a comfortable enough society that if we fail, we get to get up and try it again. If you failed, you die. Yeah. You know, you were just out there kind of on your own. But, you know, there's a lot of people that are looking around and saying, this is not how we were meant to live. This is not how we were meant to be. And I think more and more people are seeking spiritual understanding as an expression of that ideal. Mm-hmm. Some kind of freedom. And some people, I mean, look at the medication. The pharmaceutical industry feeds the American populace on a daily basis to keep them in line.
I know.
If you look at prescription rates for Ritalin, 60% of Caucasian Americans are prescribed Ritalin because they're diagnosed as having ADHD, information differently. Well, you know, there's a lot of them that are, as Timothy Leary said, turning on, tuning in, and dropping out.
Mm-hmm.
Getting back on track. When the riots were happening a couple years ago, Black Lives Matter and Ferguson and all that other stuff, about that time, about 2012, 2013, there was this, to make sure that enough Ritalin was being made available to members of the inner city African-American communities. I mean, they needed to get them in line. What better way to do it than make sure they have the proper medicine? People talk about a Prozac Nation. There are people that maybe they are waking up. Maybe they are looking at it and saying, this is not how I want to live. I want to have the time to enjoy loving my family and raise people that are going to be a part of the community. This is not conducive to that. Let's get him on Wellbutrin. Let's give him some Prozac. Let's help him do that. Now, there are legitimate uses for those medications. But
right.
If you look at some of the, I mean, there really are. There's legitimate uses for the medications, but
it's, I mean, if you look at some, your brain, like your brain creates this hormone and you know, certain.
Here's the thing.
Whatever.
Here's the thing. Those brains were designed over millions of years, one type of society, and within the last 100 years. We have changed the dynamics of that society so radically,
mm-hmm.
functions so radically, people are in legitimate pain in this world they no longer recognize. So we seek refuge in faith.
I can vouch for, I just want to say this, you know, so I'm ADHD. I was diagnosed with that as an adult, in fact. I didn't even know I had it. But anyways, what it is, for people who don't really know what it is, it's an overactive brain. So pretty much in my younger years, I probably like had that flight or fight that you were talking about a little too much, right? Going through my veins, you know? So I was depleted in a lot of different areas of your endocrine system. You know, a lot of people call it chakra, whatever you want to call it. But so that was depleted. So anyways, what you have a sensitive nervous system after that. So everything is sensitive. Your hearing is sensitive. Your smell is sensitive. Your nerves are on edge. You know, this is all kind of part of it from wearing out your body before, or your endocrine system, whatever you want to call it. That's kind of like how it is with me, but I self-medicate with this, and my followers know me.
Coffee.
I drink coffee all day long.
Let's say you have that overactive
system. But let's say you're in a forest 200 years ago, the potential for predators around you. Would that not be a benefit? So that's what I'm saying. That's my point. We have that difference for a reason. We have that power. I will call it something that would help you raise children. It would give you the edge that your children would survive.
Yeah.
Unsure world. Now we've changed all of that so much that we're comfortable and we're going crazy because we're bored to tears.
Exactly. It's adaptation. Yeah. So we're adapting to different levels of different things, but then back to our basics or tribal instincts are not being met, right? So there's where a lot of the clashes come in. And there's where, you know, we really should be, you know, like characterizing each other from a tribal sense instead of by skin color. That just drives me crazy. I'm sorry, but, you know, I know we don't have time to get into that conversation, but we are a society that characterizes other people, human beings, by the color of their skin. Like, that's what we say. Oh, well, they're this color, they're that color. And believe you me, as soon as I say that I have Indian, you know, bloodline, that I actually have an Indian card, you know, card carrying Indian, I get attacked from all different directions. But you're white, they say. And I'm like, well, I'm not really that white, but, you know, okay. I mean, whatever. You know, that doesn't, you're not going to get away from my bloodline, you know. So I'm Irish and I'm Indian. I can't do nothing about that, you know. So anyways, I'm just going to say we need to start characterizing each other more from a tribal sense in, you know, like, I don't know how you would even do that, but if somebody could figure out how to do that, maybe we need to name tribes again from different areas or rename or start reusing them instead of using color of skin, because this is never going to go away. It's never going to go away. And just like Jim said, well, that's racist. Well, you know, who knows anymore? I mean, everything's, you know what I say? This is racist, right? This color right here is racist because this color wants to be dominant and this color is racist.
That's a communist term that was created to kind of control an individual. But let's think about that for a second, this idea of race. Every race in the world, before we had this great all-inclusive culture that we consider great, which I'm not so sure about, but every one of those cultures had great achievements of science, of medicine, of architecture, of society that were based upon a commonality of culture. Their lives, their ideas, their attitudes all had this same flavor that made the idea, the expression of emotion, of thought, of reality more palatable to who they all were.
Mm-hmm.
Pyramids, you had the pyramids in Egypt, you have Great Zimbabwe in South Africa, you have Stonehenge, you have the Niebuhr Sky Dish, you have pyramids in Central America and South America, you have the great mounds of North America, you have all over the world these great things. And we can't build those today. We have encouraged all of these different cultures to give up their unique identity, and we have lost that knowledge. Now to say that man over there is different, we're robbing from them the opportunity, culture, to regain their identity and to be able to once again remember what it means to be a man. And until all of these cultural identities stand up within that cultural identity themselves as men, we are always going to have the difficulty of standing shoulder to shoulder as equals into the next horizon, which is already laid out for us, be it a spiritual one, be it the far horizon of space. Until we recognize that these cultures have the obligation to own race into the powerful identity and beings that they are, society has said, well, let's give them a handout. We'll characterize them this way. As a hand up, let's characterize them this way. And we are robbing them of the opportunity to express their own unique cultural identity. I saw 23andMe the other day. I saw a commercial. It was an African-American. His cultural roots in Africa and Nigeria and whatever. And I'm thought, you know, this is a fantastic thing. This is a good thing. Mm-hmm. The narrative that Hollywood is feeding the African-American, their mind, and is preventing them from becoming who they're supposed to become.
Right.
Put in jail. No, it's not. We don't want to be killing each other. They're killing each other and they're robbing each other because that's kind of the narrative that they're being fed. Their opportunity for becoming more is being stolen right out from under their feet. And people like Maxine Waters should be ostracized for helping ensure that happens. Yes. What a travesty. You know, nobody remembers, but it was a young Vice President Richard Nixon that invited Martin Luther King Jr. to the White House. JFK wouldn't meet him. And it was, what was it, Lyndon Baines? LBJ's the one that got that put in, the civil rights put into effect, I think. Meeting. But, you know, this is all going to change at some point. This is going to change. And those changes are going to happen either violently or we can identify them and help usher in a new era. And the liberal mindset, that whole identity, the radical idea of we're all in this together, we're all one pot, is that unique identity that allows a man to stand up as a free, intelligent, capable man in his own right. I had a friend and he was talking about being a black man in America. I'm a black man in America. This is the kind of thing that I have to deal with as black man in America. And all I could think of was, you know, how about being a man? That guy did the right about face. He turned around. Last time I heard, he was a paramedic. I'm still friends with him on Facebook. This is the problem.
Yeah.
This is a poison that corrupts our society, that individuals would be robbed of the opportunity to become everything they could become. This narrative. What a shame.
Well, yeah, because a lot of people are just told over and over and over again that they are unequal. That's why we're still fighting for equality. Come on, you guys. Everybody's equal. We're all equally human beings, you know? We live in America. We live in a country where we can take, I mean, even if you are like living on the streets right now, there are steps you can take right now. And by the end of the month, you could be in a place to live, you know? I mean, it's that simple, but yet there's roadblocks in the way as well. And I get that, you know, because everybody has to have an ID or you get nowhere. And a lot of people that are living on the streets don't have identification. But anyways, I digress. Go ahead.
I don't believe in equality. I don't believe in equality at all. And I'll tell you why. When I went through the Special Force Assessment Selection course in June of 92 or somewhere in that area, I found myself as a fairly physically fit, as a man that had a 292 PT score in the Army, I found myself to be middle of the pack. There were 300 candidates there. Some of these people have graduated West Point. Some of these people were world-class athletes. Some of these people were just fantastic. Some of them were better than me. Now, on a timeline when we're talking about equality, we're the same, but we're not. What we have is an equal opportunity to improve ourselves in this country, and people get that confused. We're not all equal. I can't fight like Muhammad Ali. I'm not as smart as Albert Einstein. What I have is an equal opportunity to train to become as good as Muhammad Ali. I have the equal opportunity to get an education to try to be as smart as Albert Einstein. Equal opportunity to develop ourselves to the culmination of what we can become. Realization when you fail to make the grade of, okay, this is my limit. And I have, for one, pushed myself to that physical limit. I know what that limit is. Not everyone is equal. Some people are smarter than other people. My grandfather Gocher told me that.
dad. My dad was, him and him were building fence, and my dad said, when Cassius Clay became Muhammad Ali, my father said, well, I'm better than any old, and he used the N-word, and my grandfather said, oh, how so? Like Jim Thorpe, can you fight like Muhammad Ali? How are you better? And so he, I've never forgot that story, but as I look at it, I realize maybe we're not all equal. I haven't done the things that Jim has done. Jim has probably done them far better than I have. But what I did have was the opportunity to try to do that. That's the thing that we've really got to look at, is that we have the opportunity. We all have the equal opportunity. It can be the beauty of America. And I think the cultural Marxists would rob us of that opportunity by telling us, oh, everybody's, no, we're not. It's there's something very unique about that makes America very special. It makes the identity of the tribe that more secure, because there are strengths and weaknesses among every person. There's a lot of work being done on tribal mindset, a lot of important work being done. I see a lot of it in the alt-right, but I see some members in Austria that are really very fond of the tribal mindset for that reason. Is that all of these old tales, even the Bible, even this ancient Christian literature, and even this ancient Asatru literature that reminds the young people of the group you need to take to be part, a successful part of this tribe. Mm-hmm. You may be the magnificent farmer, lesser identity or mindset, but we've got to figure out how to get that in perspective. Cultural Marxists would rob us of that mindset. All of y'all are factory workers. No, I ain't. and that's the problem. That's why communism failed. Well, we'll look through you. We'll sort you where you need to be. And, there's no spiritual or any of that. And, the communist threat was real. But the scare was is that to trudge the road to happy destiny as the government determined it should be. Now, with this liberal mindset, so the idea of everybody's equal may not necessarily be the case. I know a lot of people that are smarter than me. I know a lot of people that are stronger than me. What I have is the equal opportunity to do my best to keep up with them. And I think when we rid ourselves of that spirit of competition, just so we can be comfortable, well, hell, it's a very comfortable society. I can sit on couch, eat potato chips, and watch TV and think about being as strong as some of the men I know, or I can get up and go to the gym.
Well, that's true.
I actually do both because I like to eat.
That was a great explanation. I learned something from you right there. That was awesome. And that's true. But, I think we take Thank these you. Terms and we use it without really thinking about the meaning. And that was a great explanation that you gave right there on equality.
Broad brush stroke, and we forget how to love. We base our ability to deter, show affection on someone else. Broad brush stroke, someone else is painted.
Right.
Same place we are in life. Not everybody's at, some people still have some growing to do. Some people are gonna still fail.
Mm-hmm.
And I speak for our tribe, because I really can't do anything about the starving children in Africa. Yes, I don't like it. It sucks. Important concern here in my own neighborhood with this young man who we may lose to the prison system, or this young girl who thinks the value of her being is between her legs, and individual over here who's strung out on drugs. These are the kinds of things in my immediate vicinity. Ability, if I'm going to adopt this way of life, to be an example for these individuals to rise up. Let them understand you have that opportunity to become more. Isn't that the whole teaching and meaning of Jesus? When spirit rises and commands,
Yes.
That's when you can become whatever you can become. I'm very passionate about it. I believe in it 110%.
Yeah, that's a great way to explain it. And that's true. It's very true. And we can't do anything about the starving kids in Africa. In fact, people send money all the time, but we don't even, half the time it doesn't even get there, right? or what they said, right, dollar and 5 pennies goes towards it, you know, or you're sending it to their, I don't know, army of people feeding them or something. I don't know. It's just, it's crazy. It's insanity what we do. But, you know, at the same time, we mess up a lot of things around the world. And the, most of us
do it because it provides immediate gratification. It provides us immediate gratification without having to do anything. I can write a check and I've done something. Like on Facebook, I still get that same good sense of feeling. I haven't done anything to help that person. I've just given a like. Yeah. It's slacktivism at its finest, to tell you the truth. I mean, I give it a like, so there you go. That's what you're going to get.
I gave it a like.
Aren't you glad Bryan Wilton gave that a like? Get out of here.
Oh, my goodness.
You know,
that's
how it goes. So, it's just to further isolating ourselves from our ability to help people. And I think we've got to have compassion, but I think it's got to start within our families and within our homes and within the people we associate with first. That's where it's got to work the strongest.
Yeah. Or you have people like me, if I'll get off track and then before you know it, I'll be across town helping God knows who. And then Jeff's like, I'm home.
Those people are important.
Forgot about me, you know, because that's what happens over here. So.
We need those people. They're important in our world.
Yeah. So, well, Bryan, I think we're going to wrap this up. But you know what? We ought to make this like a once a week thing. I mean, we've got so much to talk about. And there's so many things, you know, that I want to talk to people about.
I'm all for it, man. If you want to do it, let's make something happen.
Yeah, that sounds good. All right. You ready to wrap it up? Why don't you tell everybody about your books real quick? So, and I'm going to put the links in the description box. So,
yeah, by all means, you can find my books on Amazon.com. You can search term Asatru, or you can search term Bryan Wilton, and you can find one of the 28 books I've written. Many of them have been bestsellers upon their release. You can find me on Facebook. You can find me at ABN Casting Network, also on Facebook. My Facebook page at Asatru Book of Days. I'm not hard to find. Just take this search Bryan Wilton and you'll see some people that don't like me.
That's all.
But
yeah.
Feel free to reach out with any questions.
I'll have your information in the link below this video once it uploads and people can find it there. All right, Bryan. Well, listen, thank you so much for allowing me to talk to you today on here. And it's just been a pleasure having you, and I learned a lot. I got a lot of insight from you. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
All right, you guys. We'll talk to you soon. Thanks for all the viewers that came today. And stick around. We'll be back with some more. Talk to you soon. Bye.